and I'm always very clear, I'm Cuban Argentine, but born and raised in New York City within the Puerto Rican community of the South Bronx. So I always have considered myself Cuban Argentine Puerto Rican. So when I was told of this opportunity that to screen the film tonight and interview the filmmaker, and there's always this affinity between Argentines and Chileans, but also someone who was actually raised in Puerto Rico and studied in Puerto Rico, like Diego Echeverria, and this film, I jumped at the opportunity. So this is Los Sures, which is a nickname for the Williamsburg section of, especially in that time, when it was predominantly Puerto Rican. We're certainly going to touch on the gentrification of what Williamsburg is today, which is very different than it was back in 1984, when it was predominantly a Latino impoverished community. So Diego Rivero was born in Chile. His parents moved to Puerto Rico with him as a child because they were professors at the University of Puerto Rico. Eventually, he graduated from the University of Puerto Rico with a degree in economics, and he moved to New York City in 71 to pursue a graduate degree in film at Columbia University. Soon after arriving to New York City, he began producing and directing films for broadcast networks, including WNET, WNBC, and eventually NBC and CBS News. Much of his early work profiled Puerto Ricans and other Latino communities and their conditions. Although he has had a lot of success with the networks, he noticed these documentaries and profiles each used what he referred as a top-down approach, which in his view left out much of the essence. So after working with NET, New York's PBS network in the 1980s, he learned of the Independent Documentary Fund, also known as the TV Lab. With PBS, he was able to make films of longer duration, including work with a series with Bill Moyers, A Walk Through the 20th Century. He also worked on the documentary Puerto Rico, A Colony, The American Raid. Finally, his desire to create a more personal exploration, a bottom-up approach of one of New York City's most impoverished neighborhoods, would be supported by TV Lab's executive producer, David. And also, there's this organization called Union Docs. His documentary, 30 years later, has resurged and is back and popular again, as they took it's a documentary-based organization in Williamsburg, so they used Los Sures as a way to create a community-based digital project called Living Los Sures. So I'd like to bring up here Diego Echeverria.
Thank you. Thank you for coming. Over many years, and to really speak about the evolution of Puerto Rican migration, Puerto Rican communities here in New York. I was born in Chile, but I was raised in Puerto Rico from the age of 8. So the country that formed me the most and gave me the most, in fact, was Puerto Rico. And I've always considered myself Puerto Rican because of the fact that that was my reality since I was very, very young. And I grew up there. We arrived when I was 8 years old. Both my parents were teaching at the university. And my experiences from Puerto Rico, looking in fact at what was going on socially, were always very much present. I was part of that generation that was actually feeling very much the impact of the forces that were really bringing the island constantly into a level of crisis. And I'd often looked at immigration from Puerto Rico as something that I would see these planes from Trans-Caribbean Airlines leaving so full of families from different towns in the island. But knowing little, as most of the people from my generation in Puerto Rico, and many of the people from my generation in Puerto Rico were in fact very ignorant about what that implied. What that implied not only from a social kind of, political kind of way, But the suffering and los quiebres, the breakdowns that really had to take place for those families that were leaving small little towns, communities that were very supportive in every single way, of extended families that were constantly around, which is what I was seeing and living in Puerto Rico, which were communities that really had a tremendous amount of support. And so when I was looking at those people leaving Isla Verde and the Trans-Caribbean Airlines, which was a very much the main airline in those years, I was flying in the 1950s to New York, there was an experience that I would see with a certain distance, but not with the awareness of what that it was implying, in fact. Imagining, in fact, that those lives would be confronting a very difficult reality. I came to New York to visit, you know, and I was able to see some of that. I was not in touch with what really went on in those communities. Until about 1971, that I basically came to live here. At a time that in Puerto Rico there was a tremendous amount of repression, and very much that generation also that was avoiding the Vietnam War, that was struggling with the fact of really being very much opposed, of a very active student movement at the University of Puerto Rico in those years. At a level of repression from the government towards anything that would be against any of those major issues that we were dealing with. And there were many like me who came here, came to study originally, and found and really started exploring and started receiving el cariño de la comunidad. There was already a community that was offering a level of support that had coalesced actually into communities that had really been here a long time, full of activities, some early institutions of support, as PETA was already around when I arrived a few years, a few others, not that many, but there were several organizations that were doing wonderful community work. Started doing some work actually as I was studying at Columbia University. I was studying film. Started doing some work in the Lower East Side, selling Claridad on 14th Street, which was a newspaper from the Partido Socialista Puerto Rican. And getting to know and to learn from what those communities had done. I had decided that I wanted to be a documentarian. That I wanted to document. Not only that, but I wanted to document society, and I wanted to document what was going on in people in societies that were marginalized. And that became something that as I was learning actually from what was going on in the US, I felt that there was a tremendous amount of expression going on that often I did not see reflected in mainstream television. So as I finished actually my studies at Columbia, and I had been already working actually in the Lower East Side and some other communities, it was only natural that I would start documenting some of those issues, some of those problems, some of those struggles that were taking place. And in 1973, I got the opportunity to start working at WNET at a program called the 51st State. And we made several pieces for those programs that were about 8-minute, 10-minute pieces. One on illegal immigration, I remember. You know, there's many Dominicans, and there were Haitians, there were people from different communities. Something about what had taken place in Newark in the 1960s. I started actually. And then suddenly I began doing more and more work with the Puerto Rican community. I got hired by WNBC. And I did a program on bilingual education and the kinds of resistance that there was in society to accept bilingual education in the early 70s. There was a tremendous resistance of saying, we don't understand that. We don't want it. And it was actually the community struggling and saying, you know, it's absolutely vital. And that is something that I started seeing as well, that there was a community that had the strength to defend and to take a stand on key issues like language, on key issues of culture, on key issues of rights. So I started doing a whole series called Visión Latina soon after. And Visión Latina was a program that later on became Visiones at WNBC. But it was an attempt to really look at the institutions, in fact, on how they were dealing with many of the issues in education. We did with Helen Rodriguez Trias, a wonderful program called Poverty and Health, contrasting areas in the Bronx in regard to the indexes of chronic diseases, how higher they were basically in certain areas, the lack of services, maternal care, prenatal care, postnatal care as well. Now, really what was going on, in fact, on how people did not have access to key information, key issues, and key services. And this lays together with stories from people telling what they have gone through. Then we did something on rights, civil rights, well, the Puerto Rican Legal Defense Fund was already one of the organizations that already existed in those years. So we began actually looking at a whole set of ways in which institutions played a key role. I don't know how many of you are here in the School of Social Work, but I imagine that this is something that might relate, because the lack of institutional support was a key issue, and it was, in fact, in those years, one of the main struggles throughout the community. There were many veterans returning from Vietnam as well, with no opportunities of employment, with severe drug dependency problems. And so, those are stories that many of you might have heard, in fact, some of you from your parents, some of you from an earlier generation. But I was very much moved by these stories. And I often felt that I was telling the story from the perspective of a reporter, that I dealt with the issues, that I dealt with the problems. But I was leaving aside the real stories, the stories that people really told me about their lives and about what they had gone through and about what were they thinking about their own communities. That I was actually leaving the real story behind. I went to work at CBS. I did some international and national coverage of news. Covered Central America in the early 80s. And I was not satisfied. I felt that I had really left out major areas. So in 1991, I made a film called El Legado, which was a film that really gathered the testimonials of those first Puerto Ricans that arrived here between in the 20s and 30s. Some of them were still alive in the 1980s. They were old, but they were still alive. So there was a woman organizer in the garment district that was fantastic. And she started telling me the stories. There was another wonderful individual that was a postal worker. And what he went through in the postal service, actually. And I was asking about how were those communities at the beginning? What was going on? What were you guys thinking? How were the struggle? So So they started telling me about the struggles in El Barrio, with the Irish, with the Italians, with the Jews, with all the other communities that were resisting the settling of Puerto Ricanos coming over. Those who were black, in fact, were not accepted in El Barrio. They had to go actually above 125th Street. And I remember always actually the story that Felipe Luciano used to tell me, because Felipe came from that background actually. If you were a black Puerto Rican, you know, you had basically very little place in those communities, because there was a tremendous resistance from other immigrant groups who had arrived a bit earlier to accepting black Puerto Ricanos in those communities. So El Legado was a reflection of that first generation, of assessing as well major political figures, some of them Puerto Ricanos, some of them, one major one, Italian, was Vito Marcantonio, who was a congressman in this district, right here, from the 1930s, 40s, and early 50s. A progressive figure that was a very important. So I got some footage from Vito Marcantonio speaking to the Puerto Rican community out in the street as he was campaigning. And that's material that El Centro will have very soon available. And Vito Marcantonio was working with the wife of Fiorello La Guardia in those years. But still, I felt, you know, that the stories were not. And then I made another documentary about a crisis, and the political crisis and economic crisis in Puerto Rico, called Puerto Rico, a Colony of the American Way, which was a reflection again about the status of Puerto Rico affecting so deeply its own future, and something that we're seeing today in ways actually, you know, that remains so, so clear. But the story still bothered me. I had not really given voice to a community. So in 1983, I was able to fund this project of looking and having an inside look at a community. And I arrived to Los Sures. I had visited the Williamsburg section where Los Sures was based. But I had not seen the kind of energy that I discovered that time when I walked into Los Sures. That wonderful community of people that had settled there from the 30s, 40s, and something like 20 blocks around that area. People that have arrived since the late 30s, I would say. And I was so moved by the conversation that I was having out on the streets. And that's when I started speaking to a young people from, had been involved in gangs, was doing some petty crimes here and there, but had a sense of leadership, of really being able, and he was absolutely lost, saying very frankly, I don't know what else I can do, this is what I know. And going through the internal struggles of having to survive with his wife and kids, and saying, I don't know how else I need to do, and what else I need to do. I found Marta Viles, who was a wonderful woman with five children, holding on to her family, and keeping actually, you know, this family together at whatever price it took, of really saying, you know, I have to go on food stamps, I'll be on welfare, I can't work, I'm a single mother, but I'll do it, I'll do it, I'll keep my family. And that sense of determination of women really hit me very strongly. Paul Cuso, construction worker, who could hardly survive from construction and would hire other people in the community. A very much loved individual who was able to, who had been raised there, who was already 46 years old or something like that when I met him. Working with his son in construction business. And keeping that work ethic, working since very early till very late and organizing things, you know, so that. I met Ana Maria at a Spiritista session, getting support from her community through religion. And I found Evelyn, who was a social worker, who was born and raised in Los Suiz, living in the worst block, seeing the drug trafficking taking place all around her, and coming to a crisis that I could not imagine the dimensions it was having, or how she was at a breaking point of just saying, I need to move, I need to keep my family. And those were the stories of this film that I made.
Five kids, and someone might say, my God, you really had a busy life, you know, in reference to a man, but it hasn't. I have lived most of my entire life by myself. Like, I've been with my children, they're the only people that I have lived with. Some people tell me, well, you're wrong, you should have never had so many kids, you know. Some people have even spoken about me having five kids in a sarcastic way where they're just gonna hold on to welfare like I have and use it and be lazy and be destructive in society. I don't.
Because he's working.
I think that my five children will work, will be educated, and become productive citizens, you know. I wish that I was a working person and that I could be, you know, the person providing for my kids and for myself. But that has not been the case. I have not been able to work. I have not been able to be properly educated to hold a job that will pay enough for me to support myself and my kids. So I have tried to do what I considered best, and that is that I am on welfare, and I received their food stamps. It's not enough. It's not enough. But it's gonna have to be enough. Because I have no other means of getting money.
Mom, can I get some?
Daddy, go find out how much the eggs cost.
You know how much the eggs cost?
Sometimes I'll owe my light, my gas, my telephone, my rent, so that I could have something to give to my kids.
What?
All that I hope is that they can appreciate it and later on in life see how hard it is. That it's not easy living on welfare. It's kind of humiliating.
Mom! Yeah. She wants keep.
Del Monte is only cost 59 cents.
The coin.
Yo necesito, tú te vas a poner con esa de leer.
I'm going to take it out. I'm going to put it back.
Look, big.
What you want?
Rum raisin. Oh, yeah.
Wait, Mommy, not rum. It tastes terrible.
For me, I like it. Better figure out what we have.
We got the lunches.
The lunches.
The rice.
The cereals. The rice. The sugar. The towels.
Beans. You need coffee?
I said beans.
I have coffee, too. Coffee.
You got bread.
We have olive
oil. We
didn't
have cold cut.
Adobo.
Pepper. No, we need pepper. No, cold
cut.
The kids ate a pound of ham in one day.
Pepper.
I buy food twice a month. Supposed to be twice a month. Sometimes I might just buy it once in one shot, like on the 14th when I get my food stamps. I buy all the expensive things, you know, like the rice and the beans and the oil and the cereals and the things that they're going to be munching on, you know. And then from there on, it's guesswork, really. Where am I going to get the next, like for the milk or the bread or anything that I might run out of. it becomes a very hard thing.
Wait up, let me count 20s first.
No me cuentes de más, que después me pongo alegre. Cuando me pongo a gastar me doy de cuenta que hay menos.
60, 80, 100,
133.
Okay, está bien. Okay, the lady downstairs.
I have known a lot of loneliness, but I don't think that that has ever made me bitter, you know, and upset. Hey, you know, what happened to me? Yeah, I question it. Why, you know, why am I still alone? I have 5 kids, and I'm by myself. The first man that I married, I had 3 children from him, and it was a very abusive man. And that's only putting it kindly. Tweety's father was a very loving man. He's a good man. We separated because of drugs. Drugs brought about a situation where it was very bad for us to keep together. So we broke up. My baby's father, I mean, you know, the last one. We never lived together, but we were together for 6 years. And doing the same thing over and over, you know, like we weren't really growing. You know, our relationship was just that way and that was it.
Uh-uh.
I think it's a good thing to be with a man, but I always fear a relationship where it's just gonna be a 1-month affair, and you know, once the fire is gone, the man is gone, you know, and all that stuff. I don't want it like that, but I want something better, because I know it exists, I know it's real, you know, and I could get it.
Be in the front at 8 o'clock at 7.
And what you did? You cut out on
me. I went back downstairs because you said it was fine.
Fine?
Yeah.
Did I tell you you could go out to the park and hang out?
What park?
That's where you was at, Christina, because I saw you coming down Rodney Street.
I was not hanging out in no park. I just finished cooking my new friend.
Tomorrow, you bring your friend's mother tell me where the hell are you, because I don't like that shit.
Because I just finished coming out from the other side right now.
No!
But I was on Terry's house.
Don't play no damn game to me, Christina. Don't. If you ever try to treat me like I'm a fool or something, I hardly ever go out, man. When I go out, are you in the front? Or I'm right there closest to where you could see me. And when I go out, I was with Jeanette. I'm going by myself. I know that.
Honestly speaking, if I was to do something wrong, I think you'll find out about it like this, because I'll be so scared, I'll tell you myself. A lot of times...
If you don't tell me, somebody else will
tell you, so...
I know.
I don't do nothing wrong.
Look, I'm not going to give no $30, not even $1.
There goes my wardrobe.
Arendela. Don't get funny now. You know what you could do for $30? Pay me $15 that you owe me first.
When I really started having problems was when my daughter was 13 years old, my oldest. And a lot of people suggested that I move out of the neighborhood because the neighborhood was no good for her. How far can I go? I know this neighborhood. I know the people. I know I could walk around. I know I could ask. I know that to an extent I'm safe here. I could say I'm among friends, you know. I don't find the need to leave Williamsburg to move to another area so that I can solve my problems. I'm gonna deal with my problems here.
Mom, we gotta have to. We have to get serious.
Not more than 4.
Oh, guys, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6.
I think that for the kids, they would have to choose either they want to live in this neighborhood or they want to get out. And if they're going to live in the neighborhood, what are they going to do to make it better? And if they're going to get out, how they're going to prepare themselves to get out of it? Because it's very hard. When you live in an area like this all your life, and this is all you've really known, how do you get out of it? How do you get out of something that this is all you know?
After making Los Sures, I went actually to work for the UN. I didn't go back to doing actually documentaries on the Puerto Rican community. That was the last film I made after having done, I don't know how many I must have done in those years. If I count the reporting stories and all that. But I felt that Los Sures was the one that actually, strangely enough, has survived. Some few years back, 5 years ago, a group of young documentarians based in this gentrified neighborhood in Williamsburg of what used to be Los Sures, or what can still be considered Los Sures, because there are still some Puerto Rican families there, few, but there are still some. They called me up and they said, we like this film, we would like to actually, you know, do something in exhibit it and show, have it shown. I never expected to get this revival with this film 34 years afterwards. Mm-hmm. 3 years afterwards. It has been something that was quite unexpected. I didn't plan it, they planned it. It's being shown all around the country again. Last night we had a screening at Columbia University with about 120 people. It ran for 7 weeks straight at a cinema in New York. Two showings at the BAM, the Brooklyn Academy of Music, brought about 600 to 700 people. And I'm still wondering, what is it that they're seeing? How come this film has a second wave? That doesn't happen to many of my documentarian friends who chose maybe different kinds of stories as valid, as good, and even as better made than Los Sures. So that's a reflection maybe of what's in Los Sures that, and I'm still trying to answer that question, to tell you honestly.
Well, let me start with the end, mm-hmm. which is, I didn't get to see the film till this afternoon, and it's so ironic because this afternoon Melissa Margaretito, who's the city council speaker, gave her last, her third and last state of the city council, and so she's a friend. This is her community, her East Harlem, and so I wanted to see. Since, you know, her term expires, and it's her third term, this is it for her, I wanted to see what she had to say. And then at the same time as she's giving her speech, Trump is giving his first press conference. Mm-hmm. And you know that's always good theater. And so I was crossed in between. I wanted to see, it was live streaming her speech and seeing on TV Trump when there was a reporter by the name of April Ryan, who's an African-American female reporter, asked him a question. And he started talking about the devastation of inner city communities and how bad and horrible they're at. Because that's his line. When he thinks of black communities, he immediately went into the inner city communities and how
you're reading about an interesting subject here, because it's an interesting perspective.
But
the put down of our communities has always existed, okay? And most probably from that perspective, I don't doubt that it is in fact a condescending putting down of our communities. I mean, that's perspective from the optic of. And I think that Los Sures for me was an attempt to really turn things around, getting to know this wonderful people from which we took certain kinds of lessons about life. But we took actually as well the fortitude in which those communities have been founded, have been based. And that's, I think, in most of the films I made, I try to always show them. But Los Sures was also difficult with our community. And that's an interesting kind of perspective, because very often people come, why do you have to show so much poverty, so much of an environment where there is actually, you know, so much struggle? Why can't you show a story that's a bit more positive? Why can't you just show actually what community organizers are doing to resolve the problems? I had already done many films about those things. I wanted to do a film actually that was based on the experiences of people. People like Marta, people like Cuso, people like Tito. But many people found it a difficult film to understand. I even got some serious kind of comments from politicians in our community, and even community organizers saying, Diego, you know, I'm missing something. I'm missing something.
But that's my point, that 33 years later, sadly enough, we're still going through the same.
We're still going through, but there is an evolution in our community as well, and a strength to combat and to organize and to afrontar.
But as I also shared with you, Lillian Jimenez, who had done a documentary on Dr. Antonia Pantoja, that last year, the founder of Aspira, that last year's, you know, celebrated its 55th anniversary, that was created specifically targeting Puerto Rican impoverished kids living in inner city communities. And Lillian Jimenez, less than a week after Trump was elected, when her documentary screened again, said, and this, so if we're shocked 33 years later, we're still going through the same. She felt 55 years later, if Dr. Antonia Pantoja was alive today, she would be shocked, you know, because we're still going through the same fight she fought. But I understand, also as a fellow documentary filmmaker and turning the camera on our community and inner city communities, that sometimes we do get criticized. But what I wanted to touch on with you is what I loved about your film was, to me, it smacked of cinema verite. You just let the camera roll. I didn't feel it was editorialized. It was almost a very Maisel's-like effect. You just let that,
It isn't, because I'm interviewing people. In cinema verite, you often leave the camera just very much more passively than I did.
But we never the beauty was we never heard any of your questions.
Because there were ongoing, it was an ongoing conversation. Even to the point that when I chose the people that are in this film, I asked them, don't tell me much about yourself. Don't tell me that much, because I need to listen to your stories for the first time. So if you tell me, so there was almost an instinct that was driving me to really contain myself. But then once we began filming, I began to know them a little bit, and I started actually interviewing them. Things flowed so easily. There was so much trust built. But I was interviewing them. So it was passive to some extent, because we are recording their day-to-day life. You know, so, but at the same time, there's an arch of an interview of their inner self being expressed through the conversations that we had.
As a compliment to you, even if Trump had not been elected, your film 33 years later would still be relevant, because what it smacks of to me is, you know, I was in my early 20s then. It's a time capsule. It's a time capsule of the Puerto Rican
community. People are saying that, yes.
It's, you know, the
PR one. And very strange, because even when we had the showings, let's say, I remember, in fact, in those many weeks that we were showing at the Metrograph, people would approach me. And the mothers who had lived in those SURES would come with their children, who had become professionals, with their grandchildren, who were becoming professionals, and saying, life was tough. And what you portrayed there is exactly how life was. But we knew that we had to surmount all those difficulties. That we had to really overcome those challenges. And there is no doubt that that's what makes a community like Osuda so exceptional. And those communities have existed along the way in certain blocks in East Harlem. I mean, I remember closing a block in East Harlem, 104th Street, I think it was. I don't know if it was between 2nd and 1st or 2nd and 3rd. Bringing in some music and closing the streets and having people, or a documentary that I made on music. And I could see people knew each other. They would make jokes with each other. There's a community, actually, and you know this better than I do in many ways, I mean, that is so rich in its expression, and its expression of affection, support, solidarity with one another. And that's the first impression that I got when I first came to New York. It was a strength.
See, the other point I want to take up with you is, I think another point of relevance is that Williamsburg now is not.
It's not.
It's because that, you know, the G word,
yes.
the pink elephant in the room, or the orange elephant in the room, the gentrification.
Yes.
Williamsburg in Brooklyn. Brooklyn is now considered the most expensive borough.
I know.
For rent affordability, yes. You know that. They, if anything, the hipsters were running there because they couldn't afford the Manhattan rents. Now, one bedrooms in Williamsburg start off at $2,200.
Yeah.
I mean, I've known people who have money, who make $100,000 a year, and were looking to buy an apartment in Williamsburg, and would tell me, if I bought an apartment in Williamsburg, I would not have any money left for shopping, for food, after maintenance and paying the mortgage. That's how expensive Williamsburg is now. So how do you see the subject of gentrification?
Gentrification, actually, it's very... I've been long enough in New York. Right now I live in Miami and retired. I decided that I did not want to live in New York any longer, so I come twice a year or so. But when I look back at the experiences, and many of you are New Yorkers and have lived here long enough, I've seen the changes in the neighborhood, so I don't think that we need explanation how neighborhoods have changed along the way. I used to live in the Upper West Side, and I remember the Upper West Side in 1971, let's say, full of little rooms of single room occupants, it used to be called in those years.
SROs,
exactly. And I don't know if you remember, well, you're not old enough.
Yes, I am.
Yes. You remember on Broadway how they used to sit right in the middle of Broadway getting the sun for the first rays actually in spring?
On Broadway. Right in the middle of the avenue.
Right in the middle.
Needle Park,
exactly.
Which was Verde Park.
72nd, exactly.
And now you can't get your big toe in there.
There, exactly.
One bedroom apartments there sell.
I know.
At 1 million. They start at 1 million.
But what I mean is the fact that we've seen gentrification taking place. We're seeing it in this neighborhood as well. We're seeing it actually, I'm saying even some of those beautiful brownstones in Harlem. You know? So we've seen it. But there is a process that we often say there is a lot of speculation. There's no doubt real estate speculation in New York actually, you know, makes gentrification and accelerates the process. But at the same time, our own communities, in fact, are much more flexible than we tend to often recognize that they are. People often don't want to stay once their children are grown, once they're ready to retire. The children might have moved to North Carolina, they might have gone, in fact, to Kissimmee, or they might have gone to Tampa, or people are looking actually to move with their families. So there is a displacement that we need to acknowledge as well among our own people. And today families are pretty much, you know, going through that process. I mean, Marta moved away. She could not climb the stairs of her sixth door Laura, actually, in the building that she...
I was going to ask you a follow-up, if you're still in contact with these families.
I'll give you whatever a little bit of...
Marta,
yes.
Marta,
but let me finish here a little bit of what I see, yes. Of, I've seen Marta struggling with the 84 or 87 steps that she needed to climb. So she moved to Kissimmee, where her daughters are. You know? So we need to acknowledge that aspect, yes.
That's it. I'm going to ask you so many questions. I don't want to steer the conversation wrong. I know you said you want to sort of stand.
I love the fact that it's a conversation. I hope that you all bring your own experiences to this.
My name is Vincent. I'm a film student at Hunter, but I'm in New York. I grew up on 105th, and then we moved to El Barrio. This is my neighborhood. I know Marta. I know her children. I mean, that's my life. Right? So I guess the first question I want to ask you is the resurgence with new interest in the film and the documentary that you did. Have you been able to notice or find out if it's having any impact directly on the community for people? Because even now, still, for instance, they call East New York the final frontier. It's like the last place where all the developers there are now. Yes. China, right? And so there's people who are struggling with the issues of being able to afford to live in the hood.
Yes.
Right? And I know, for instance, the Blasio administration seems to be working to help people that are struggling and getting priced out of their neighborhoods, and it's interesting on so many different levels, because you have the cultural,
yes.
You have the gentrification,
yes.
You have the economic,
yes.
You have the institutions, the schools,
yes.
right? So it's so many different directions you can go in.
Yes.
But have you been able to find out if the interest in your film from 30 years ago, is it having any direct impact on the community?
It does, and it's been a reflection on many issues having to do with our reality in this city and our evolution in this city. And that's what I'm finding most interesting are the conversations about, not on how I made the film, what kind of situations were happening in the neighborhood at the time, but it's the implications of the many layers that people are coming back to me and saying, I remember, in fact, let's say the part of having to do with the expression of creativity by young people, breakdancing. We have a full sequence there of breakdancing in 1983. That's amazing. People gathering around the neighborhood and everybody sort of, participating in this event. And last night I was taking some of the notes of what people were bringing about, the aspects of having to do with community building, how you build a community, what sustains it, what are the forces actually that are acting as forces actually that bring people together. There are the aspects of cultural identification that are so strong. And in our case, language becomes such an instrument also, as we were going actually constantly flowing from Spanish to English back to Spanish and so on. Even when we're angry, you know, you say it in Spanish, you know. You know that the situation is getting better as you're switching to English. There were many aspects, actually. The aspect having to do as well with distrust of the system. There's a full sequence, and I wish we would have had, to some extent, the chance of discussing it, having maybe viewed the whole set of... But there are elements that people are valuing and are seeing that I felt that when it came out in 83, people were not ready for so much. It needed a certain kind of perspective of time, and I think that that's what you've been addressing to some extent, of saying why is it that a film, it's so strongly 30 so years. And I see people coming to me and saying, that's a photograph of me as a kid in Los Sures with my parents. And that's so moving. You know, so even for mis abuelos were there, you know, and I'm the product of a two generation, my parents grew there, but I'm no longer live there. Or I live there and I'm an artist right now in Williamsburg. I find that fascinating.
I was struck by Marta's situation. Something that struck me when I saw her story was, I saw welfare moms like that in my community in the South Bronx in the 60s, 70s, and 80s. President Clinton dismantled welfare. So you wouldn't see this, you wouldn't see families like that.
Yeah, that started in the Reagan era. That started already when we were actually filming. That was the beginning part.
But by the mid-90s, one out of nine New Yorkers was living on welfare.
Yes.
And between Giuliani and the dismantling by Clinton, that's why I'm saying for me it was a time capsule, because are we any better off in society as social reformers? Yes. Is history repeating itself? Well, I mean, it always brings that recurring theme again.
It's interesting even to see what happened to these people that were in this film. And that's an interesting situation, because Marta was out of welfare 2 years after we filmed.
Really?
And she started working. She worked most of her life. Her kids, actually, she was very much able to keep that family together.
Wow.
Hold on to her family.
Did she get her wish? Did the kids progress in life?
To some extent, the younger ones actually more than the older ones, you know. But yes, some of the other people, some of the children, one became a fireman, another one became a teacher. Tito became a super in one of the buildings. Puso has his wonderful, beautiful extended family after having been in construction for many years.
Puso's now in his 70s.
He's in his 80s, 80, 81, 82, or something like that. So here you have people that really, all of them, had very beautiful lives. Evelyn, the one also that we have, became a mid-level executive at the Bellevue Hospital.
She was the college educator.
She was a college educator.
Who was a community
organizer, yes.
This lady had a question.
Yes.
My name is Kate. I study film sociology, everything to do with the Latino experience in the United States, especially New York, at Fordham University. But ever since I moved here 4 years ago, I'm from Wisconsin, actually, completely different.
Mm-hmm.
I've just become involved and completely fallen in love with New York and all Puerto Ricans, Dominicans, Cubans, I'm Guatemalan, and Mexicans. Just being here is so lovely. I've met friends and families from Los Sures who come from there. But, the word that we're talking about before, gentrification, is such a touchy issue here. And you were talking about there's some sort of self, leaving the community on yourself, not being pushed out by force.
There are two forces, because you're being pushed as well. That exists.
Exactly. So, but is it okay just to view Los Sures as a time capsule and then accept that you can charge $6 for coffee in Williamsburg now?
Yes, exactly.
You're I mean, it kind of like, that was beautiful what it was before, but now it's like otra cosa, and you can be like, oh, yes. Now this is completely different. It's not the integrity that the neighborhood was before, and people kind of, to me and to my friends, are just like, over it, it's Williamsburg now. Like, they can charge you $6 for coffee, so yes. To me that's very conflicting.
Yes.
And
yes.
But even within the pop, you know, so as you're saying, some critics were like, why are you just focusing on what seemingly is negative?
Yes.
But even within the universe, Marta, when she was making her coffee, and she's doing it the way we did it and do it traditionally,
exactly.
With a sock.
Yes.
It, you know, yes. And that put a smile on my face because those were my happy memories for someone that came from inner city community where I had a happy childhood,
yes,
amidst poverty. And, you know, her kids, you know, they're in the supermarket, 59 cents for a can of corn, which now would be nothing, but I'm sure 30 years ago, when you're getting $130 in food stamps to feed five kids and yourself, you know, every nickel and penny counted for her. But there was happiness within,
yes,
these families. There was happiness in the community, even that cultural,
yes,
you know, festival where they were dancing.
But
in
the perspective from today is quite interesting. Following Los Sures, or at the same time that Los Sures was starting to get this, over a period of about 5 years, Union Docs worked on this project called Living Los Sures. And I invite you to see it on the internet. It's a web-based documentary film. Based on everything that was in the film, decomposing the film, following the characters, the primary characters and the secondary characters, and following everything that has taken place, and creating an arch of continuity of the transformation of the neighborhood. What's interesting is that they have, as this is a collective of documentarians in Los Sures. I don't know how many of you might have heard of Union Docs. But it's a center for documentary media, quite important right now in the city.
If you're filmmakers, you should look that up because they give workshops, they,
yeah,
have screenings.
You would very much, I think, would enjoy
you can,
getting in touch with them, okay?
And tell them that
you came here and that I suggested that you go there. Because it's really a center for training, for thinking together with other people that are making documentaries. And people that are coming from all over the world to Union Docs to speak about documentaries. I mean, this is a major center for documentary filmmaking. So they have produced and they have done a series of 40-something documentaries, short documentaries, on those experiences today. Now we will show you one documentary that is taking the theme of Los Sures and reflecting upon what the community has become. Okay? Interviewing, would you like to see it? And okay, let's hit the second one.
So you're in Brooklyn, and people ask where you're from, and you're Latino, and you would say Los Sures, and they would know exactly where you're from. Soy de Los Sures.
Los Sures. Los Sures. Los Sures. Los Sures. Los Sures.
What is the South Side?
I guess it was a big community of immigrants.
It was a really vibrant, interesting neighborhood, mostly Puerto Rican.
For anybody to say Los Sures now is weird.
I believe it's a fading term. I mean, it's safe to say that.
I used to have a boat, and we used to be able to put in at Grand Street. I remember one time going up to the Greenpoint Terminal Market, and they had a big pier that stuck out into the river, and the pier was left entirely as it was one day when it looked like the workers had just walked out of there and never come back. And there were still lockers with newspapers and coats and hats in them, and there were still like big bags of coffee piled up, and everything was like dusty. So it was really nice to explore, you know, the river, the industrial past of the neighborhood.
I remember there were three major theaters right there on Broadway.
The Commodore. I've gone there with my father many times.
But that was like Saturday, 50 cents, three movies, plus cartoons, like, you know, that was your day.
You know, the movie theaters for young people was it. It was Hollywood, it was magic. And I would go with my mother, you know, and of course, it was crazy because people was talking to the movie, you know, don't do that, you know, in Spanish, right? You're crazy.
My grandmother would like bring food, it was like picnicking.
Everybody.
And the whole family would go in there and
into the counter. I never thought of myself as poor, but you know, now when we think back, yeah.
Those kinds of things that I experienced are gone.
Que parecen soles.
I remember my grandma, she smelled of alcohol. But she was so sweet. Everybody called her Titi. It means aunt. Like, it was a term of endearment. And it was weird because, like, everyone in the neighborhood did so, you know, like, kids, alcoholics, like, the young drug addicts would all go to her Titi. It was, like, this thing where she just knew everybody. Yeah, she always walked around with this little plastic cup of rum and coke. Like, the whole time, that was her thing. And, you know, every store owner would fill it for her. She lived across the street from this park. It's on Rodney Street. And there's a basketball court there. It's kind of run down at the time. There was, like, a broken sofa. We'd hang out there. Titi, she'd come out, you know, give me a quarter to go play video games, and then she'd go back upstairs with her friends. Since she lived on the first floor, everyone who hung out outside would just, like, use her, like, apartment as their restroom. So the whole neighborhood would just, like, come in until my aunt would come in, just, like, you know, throw everybody out.
I can remember
that blackout.
And I was going up into my building, and when the lights went out, I think we were watching TV, or my grandmother was watching TV. What happened to the television? You know, what's going on? The fans went off.
I mean, there were riots everywhere. I mean, they were looting all stores.
And we were actually seeing people walk by with TVs and, you know, refrigerators and hand carts and, you know, boxes of sneakers. And the economy had a lot to do with, you know, with what happened. People got very wary of neighbors and not knowing what to suspect. You know, I could probably pinpoint that as a defining moment in the decline of that whole community. It was that devastating.
I remember
a gangster.
There was about four bikers that I knew, the unknown bikers.
I think the Majestics was one of the gangs, and the Chinglings.
The Dukes.
Oh, there was also the Vampires. They wore capes.
My brother was a prospect in Mystery Nights. They wore jackets, almost like the Warriors, that old movie. When you hear a rumble of motorcycles coming down and you hear cling, 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 chains, you see everybody's mother calling out the window, Chichi, Milagro, Frankie, Pedro, pa dentro.
And so we had to all go upstairs while they set up, and you know, they rumbled like right downstairs.
Bike, chains, trash cans come flying, blah, blah, blah. And they trash some bikes get there, some guys get bloody noses, and guys get beaten with bats. You know, 30 minutes later, La Jara, La Policia, let's go.
It's romanticized now in narratives of print and film.
It's human nature to sort of romanticize the past.
But it was hard. When you hear the sort of excitement people's talking about that period, is that they survived it. You don't know what it was like. I do, because I survived it. This was, of course, the teenage gang capital of New York City. We lost 48 young people in the South Side, 1 square mile. Population maybe about 32,000 in a 12-month period from 1979 to 1980.
It was a whole infestation of drugs and gang activity. Los Sures was really, I mean, it was a war zone. Traditionally, think of what the South Bronx looked like. It was exactly what Los Sures looked like.
We had a thought and a power organization. So we had a build-up puente, a community and youth development organization. Then I'll know that things will get back to what they should be, and we will clean up the gangs and we'll begin to have a new community again.
Okay.
What a b-boy is known as currently is a breakdancer. An individual who spins on his back and his head or pops and locks. Back then, that dancing was a way to decrease that violence. So if you did have a problem with somebody, you use your physical movement and vent it out by saying that, you know what, I can dance better. We join together and form a group and then recognize as breaking his style. It was like, okay, well, this guy made something for himself, they're a b-boy crew. It's cool when you can stay on your block and everyone knows you're on your block, but when they know you 5, 10, 15 blocks down in the barrio that you live in, that's like, wow. Going to Vinny's Pizza Rapper, like, what's your next battle? Oh, you guys all mine? Okay, we'll give you a discount. That's why I made it so cool, that people like mini mayors or movie stars or ghetto superstars at the fact that, yeah, we were b-boys.
There was a hot crew in the community that all the kids liked. And so I got to this hot crew and said, oh, where are you practicing? He said, well, mostly in the street. I said, how about if I give you a real place to practice? Really? I said, yeah, really nice dance floor and everything. He said, yeah? I said, there's only one condition. You're not going to pay for anything. I just want to be able for other young people to watch you. Well, we don't show our moves. I said, no, that's the deal. If they can watch you practicing and maybe join in on the practice, word got out, this place was packed. I had literally hundreds of kids here. I remember the species called the artist.
I moved here in November 1984, because I'd come out of art school.
Because I was a painter at that time.
When I came here, I had this idea I wanted to be a community artist to be able to live and work in the same community.
Early on, there were non-Latino artists who came to live in the South Side. They were part of the community. They are part of the community.
Compared to Manhattan, it was really peaceful, especially if you went down to the abandoned warehouses on the waterfront that kind of feel the history, leftover bits of the industrial past.
So I was looking for a place with another guy. So I came here and I found that this was a total dump, gigantic dark hole or cave that had all this horrible smell in it, you know, because apparently somebody kept their dog here without walking their dog. But there was something about the giant size that I liked, very big and raw and exciting. So I said, okay, we'll take it.
Then the second place I lived was on Hope Street, with the top floor of this loft building. It was still, you know, garment factories underneath, and they would shut the heat off at the end of the workday. There was no heat on the weekends. Yeah.
I had credit for pet food and any veterinary care I might need, and then I could get beer, anything else I needed at the bodega on credit, and I had credit at Teddy's, the bar, so I could go out, be with my friends, and It was pretty comfortable.
And even though the neighborhood was very dangerous at that time, there were gangs and there was shootings all the time. And I kept the front door, the garage door open, trying to deal with the mess. People came and they would try to sell me drugs or just chat or have a beer.
We were doing the murals on Continental Army Plaza. That park was really just a hot mess. It was, you know, it was where, you know, people go to smoke crack, and it was just like full of like broken glass and dog feces.
The people in the building were impressed by what I did here. Even though these hardly speak any English and I hardly speak any Spanish, but suddenly there were walls, electricity, 4.5 years to fix it and bring it up to a condition where it's livable. But then when I was sort of finished, people told me, oh, this is your best work.
What is, in many ways, a threat to the concept of humor are people coming and living here and using it almost as a dormitory, the permanent tourist.
como espuma que inerte lleva el caudaloso río.
Things can look like they're like forlorn and broken down, but no, but there's like, there was a soul there.
In the beginning, I would always wonder, what am I doing here? And kind of thinking of it as a temporary solution to my problem of how to be an artist. But now that I've been here 21 years, my roots have kind of grown into this soil.
When the bodegas start to go, that would be a huge loss, in part because they make really good coffee and I like this fancy coffee.
I don't really know where else I would live. You know, this is really my home.
And I think that's what is appealing to outsiders when they move in, is that like, sense of like inner city grit that's there. But for others, it meant so much more.
I think the time that I can say I can feel mostly bonded to my childhood is just opening up a fire hydrant, looking out for cans, scraping the cans just to make a nice little tube so I can just raise up water and just share it along with everybody. In other words, I had control. Do I feel proud that I'm a Brooklynite from Williamsburg, Los Sures? You bet I am. You know, am I proud of my community? Yeah, especially those abuelos and abuelas and mamas and pops older than me that are still in there. And believe it or not, some of them are struggling because of the economic changes. But you know what? They're still there. De donde tú eres, de Los Sures?
How was funding, getting funding to accomplish this?
That's actually, you know, it was a lucky streak. I had been working already in television for over 10 years when I got to do this film. So there was a track record of having worked for NBC News and CBS News and having done, you know, international stories.
Because I see you had the Ford Foundation Corporation for Public Broadcasting,
yes.
The NEA that Trump wants to wipe out.
Yes.
The Independent Doc Fund.
But it was
fund.
Mostly the TV Lab from Channel 13 that provided something like 70%. The other ones actually came, you know, as a smaller funder. Also because the film was going over budget along the way, you know. But it was a film that actually, Los Sures was an hour-long film done in about 10 months or something like that.
And you know what's sad? WNET, Channel 13, PBS, they don't have funds like that.
No. And it was a very special
and you know who's on their board? The Koch brothers.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
No.
I rest my case.
Exactly.
Any questions?
But it's, any questions or comments or?
My name is Ruben Kratz. I was born here. My father came in 1915. My mother 19.
Really? Your father came in 19?
Yes. He told me the story. He came as a young boy as a stowaway.
Puerto Riqueño.
From Puerto Rico, definitely. Ponce.
No, Maria. You know what? That's an incredible story. Your father came when he was basically a baby.
A young teenager on his own. He was a stowaway. So I told him, so you're really a Mexican? Just making fun with him, you know, of the old stereotype that they say about people.
You see, the Jones Act, which made Puerto Ricans American citizens, was 1917.
Yes.
So he came prior to the Jones Act, which was quite an accomplishment.
Sure.
Someone from...
There were Puerto Ricans here. But
there were
many.
Very few.
Puerto Ricans have been here since the late 1800s.
But that's when, that was the beginning of the migration, was 1901, when Puerto Ricans started coming here. So your father was really one of the first.
He was born the early part of that
migration.
Yeah, right after the invasion.
Where did he settle?
Columbia, I believe, Columbia Street.
Columbia Street,
down
on the Lower East Side.
Yeah, the dock. No.
Oh, Columbia Street and
Atlantic
Avenue.
Atlantic Avenue.
In Brooklyn. Atlantic.
Where the docks are at.
Yes, exactly.
Was he a longshoreman?
No. He came as a teenager, 15 years old. And he Well, that's one of the neighborhoods. Yep, I believe also around near the bridge, the Brooklyn and the Manhattan Bridge area.
Yes.
And they were scattered.
Yes.
Very scattered Puerto Ricans.
Yes.
Here's the town's story. But I was born in another part of Brooklyn, which is called Bed-Stuy.
Yes.
Which is the border exactly. Near
exactly.
Flushing and Broadway.
Exactly.
In a tenement building.
But you see what happened as well.
I'm talking about the 50s, so it was a different.
In the 1930s of the 20s, that's when the marine tigers, okay, started actually arriving actually from that
yeah,
area.
That's one
okay.
Of the main ships, yeah.
And people would get down, and we have a list of people coming in the Marine Tigers, and they had to give the address of where they would be staying.
Yes. Yes, I have that.
And many of them would get off the boat, go a few blocks, and they were staying right nearby in the yeah. Williamsburg section, because the Marine Tiger actually was near the Navy Yard. That's where they were actually, you know.
Right.
So it was only a few blocks away from Los Sures.
See, I grew up different than what the stories you have here.
Yeah.
Now, so like, I relate to it somewhat, because in the 50s it was different. And of course, I did come from a tenement, but then from there we moved to an Italian American neighborhood.
Yeah.
So then I grew up Italian with the Puerto Rican culture.
Yeah.
We grew up differently from what I see here.
Yes.
I went to private school, so we had our own. Business, I own property, you know that.
Yes.
Except for all of my friends, all were on welfare.
Yes.
But the parents couldn't work, the mothers couldn't work, but the father, well, one of them, I knew the father was a migrant worker going out to the island.
Yes.
Yeah.
Exactly.
But that's because your family has been here for 100 years. A
yeah.
Lot of these
as of my father.
Because of the 1901 migration. I mean, a lot of these families, the big bulk was 1950.
Exactly.
So, yeah. You know, as we saw with the Jews to the Lower East Side, then they moved up to the Bronx, then from the Bronx they went to New Jersey, Long Island, Westchester. So the same, so the migration of your family progression took a natural, healthy route that a lot of immigrant families took, you know, followed in this country. In two of your stories, you couldn't possibly talk about the Puerto Rican culture, and especially in that era, without religion. And
yes.
In two different stories, one, and again, the quintessential, their lives hit rock bottom, so they go to religion. And so one family went the route of esperitistas,
yes.
And then the quintessential, what we know of these neighborhoods, los pentecostales, out in the street, the open air, aleluya, you know, we used to call them the aleluyas.
Yes, yes,
yes,
yes,
yes.
The non-Catholics, yes.
So it was that whole thing of, you know, out of desperation, as she said. You
religion
know,
plays a very important role, you know, religious support is essential in the community and really provided. We have a whole sequence of Ana Maria in the Espiritista session. And that was actually something that, you know, I found her there. And it was very moving to have the stories of people confronting the realities, you know, in front of others in a session like that.
Yet, one of his characters in the story is from the neighborhood, is college educated, Evelyn. And Evelyn, you know, was from the community, had two kids, but she went to college, and then she was part of the National Council of Neighborhood Women. And she was really a neighborhood advocate, activist. I mean, there was one family whose the brownstone, I wouldn't even call it a tenement,
yes.
Burnt down. And here are the families coming out. You know, one family had 8 kids, and their apartment was burnt out. And the American Red Cross was not coming until the following day. So she's on the microphone in this documentary from the fire truck saying, we need 3 cars and there's no pay. And she's doing this in Spanish. And it was wonderful to see one of our own who had come up in the world, you know, who had killed herself, I think even going to night school to get her college degree, and then gave it back to the community. Those are wonderful stories. I mean, I am very sensitive to stereotypes about our community and people who, storytellers, even from our community, who exploit our community.
Yes.
But I never felt your story had anything to do
with exploitation. Well, that's why I wanted for you to see as well, you know, the stories of how actually, you know, 30 years, more than 30 years afterwards, this other filmmaker completes the arch of remembering what it used to be. And the love that they still feel for the neighborhood. And I think that there is actually always some of that that has remained actually with our experiences in each one of the neighborhoods.
Yes.
Hello, my name is Joshua Craig. I'm an actor. I just moved to New York in November from Virginia. First off, your film is great. I love it. It's awesome. I'm new to documentaries. My manager is actually in documentaries, like she worked at CNN, and now she's at PBS. It's great, okay? It related to me, and I'm not from New York, you know, I'm not from a neighborhood, I was a foster kid, I moved around a lot, but it related to me economically and gentrification-wise, okay? Economically because, first of all, the film was, I like the time capsule thing, because I was like, yo, that's food stamps. You know what I mean? Like, what I know about stamps is
paper,
right? Okay? So I'm seeing that, and I'm like, all right, that's cool. You know, because I went through that, you know, but it was a car, and it was like, whatever. And then moving up here, so when I moved up here, I moved to East New York, right? I moved to New Lots down into the 3 on Essex, right? And, so when I moved here, they're like, yeah, where are you from? Or where'd you move to? I was like, oh yeah, East New York or East Side. I said East Side or something like that. And I was getting it wrong. But then when I was getting it right, I was like, East New York, people were like, wow, you live out there? And I was like, I don't get it. What's wrong with it, you know? And they were talking about it's hard or whatever. I love it. The coffee's 75 cents. Like, I've never been, I mean, you know, I've been to New York for classes and stuff like that. But living there, getting, you know, 1 o'clock in the morning,
yes.
You know, hey, I left. Oh, I don't have my money on me. Let me get you in the morning. Okay. Like, it's crazy, right?
But that was the interesting part of actually seeing in this last piece, which I did not make, actually. That's not my piece, okay? That was done by a younger filmmaker who used Los Sures as a springboard to go and explore the community again. And they made something like 40 films at Union Docks, okay, of people going and exploring the community today. I'm just showing you one of them. But he was able to connect the remembrance aspect, the happiness that really Los Sures brought about to people, knowing that they belonged to a community, that it was a cohesive place to grow up. And that's essential, and that's what I've been listening to since the film had this revival. So it has been one of the greatest joys of really seeing, you know, people in fact that are the children of children having lived there. I don't know if we should actually leave it here or...
We're going to leave it here. I want just one thing that struck me. There was one line that one character in the film said, and this is what, again, back in 83, 84, she said, once there was some joy, not anymore,
and then
just sadness.
Sadness, that's Evelyn, yes.
And so here's this college-educated Puerto Rican.
And going through a tremendous crisis because her building basically was a trading post for drugs.
Right.
And she could not take it anymore.
And it was funny when she used the word junkie. She says, you know, yeah, we're used to always having experienced junkies in the neighborhood. She said, but you know, they'd be tipsy, they'd be hanging out in the wall. All they wanted to do was just get high. And she says, now, you know, they have guns. Now they fight. And so it was even within the world of a junkie, there was an evolution which prompted her to say, there used to be joy. And now, you know, now they're just plain drug addicts. And so it was interesting to see what it's become now. So in closing, is showing us from their perspective now and yours, is Los Sures the same, better, or worse than it was then.
It's different.
It's different. Okay. That's very diplomatic. That's very diplomatic. And so,
Thank you.
Last thing is, so as these are and were quintessential immigrants, as that has become a bad term now.
Yes.
When you're asking why is this so relevant,
as we're
still debating the subject foolishly enough,
exactly.
What are your last two cents on immigration, and what they brought, and what people are bringing today?
Well, this is our own history here. Actually, you know, we're all arrived to some extent. And for myself, even for many years, I did not want to see myself as an immigrant. I was going back and forth to Puerto Rico, where I had my roots, you know. I was your typical Puerto Rican, you know, kept on going back. My family was there, my parents were there, my friends were there as well. So I always had that difficulty, although, you know, you go through a stage of saying, you know, this is my life. And I became a New Yorker, I became a Puerto Rican, you know, New York. Thank you.
Diego Echeverria.